Hola otra vez, amigos. Ya me hacía falta ya un poco de corte de pelo. Me imagino que todos ustedes vieron la entrevista que hice con Gutenberg y no hay ninguna otra explicación porque ayer cuando salió la entrevista mis suscripciones subieron al triple, así que sí, todo el mundo vio la entrevista. Y mi esposa me dice: "Oye, pero te veías tan feliz y te oyes tan bien en inglés, mucho más fluido. En tu canal te ves mal serio". Primero que estaba súper emocionado de estar con Steve Gutenberg en mi casa. Y segundo que cuando hago este tipo de grabaciones estoy tratando de concentrarme de que cada otra palabra que digo no sea una burrada y que la batería de la cámara esté bien. Y el enfoque, bueno, ya algún día aprenderé a hablar enfrente de una cámara. Hoy les traigo, y yo sé que siempre digo eso en todas las introducciones, pero hoy se le traigo un capítulo emocionante. ¿Por qué? Porque les traigo una entrevista a David Chesky y Steve Gutenberg, los dos a la vez. No soy digno, no soy digno. Así que, bueno, como van a ver, los dos son unos bromistas de primera. La entrevista es muy corta. Espero que la disfruten y que sigan disfrutando su música y que se les sigan parando los pelos a todos. Hola amigas y amigos audiófilos, estoy aquí con las superestrellas del audio, David Chesky y Steve Gutenberg. Hey you guys, how's your Spanish?
Perfect, perfect. Sí.
Bienvenidos,
Bueno.
bienvenidos a su casa. So, as you may know, I am exploring the idea of questioning, asking people what they think about what makes differences in sound equipment, let's say the cables and the needles, the turntables, and all that stuff. So I was wondering, who do you think it's more neurotic, the musicians or the audiophiles?
Well, musicians would be a subset of musicians. Most musicians are normal until you get to oboe players with the reeds.
Ooh.
And that's probably the most neurotic thing in the world because audiophiles are neurotic with the place things. Musicians are not neurotic, they just want to play well, so they put in a lot of time practicing. But you get to this subset like double reed players, like bassoon, oboe, English horn is probably the worst. And they're like crazy borderline, maybe should be institutionalized neurotic because, if the reed is not this and this, I mean, if you go to one of these people's houses, you see piles of reeds everywhere.
I saw
Reeds,
them,
oh,
yeah.
not here, no. But I'm saying that's probably the most neurotic thing, double reed players.
I knew you were going to bomb my interview, but anyway, thank you. Steve, so how can audiophiles be neurotic?
How? They wake up every morning and they're neurotic. I had this Japanese customer when I was a salesman, and he told me that in Japan, really heavy, audiophiles, they have this thing about bonding with their system. And if their system isn't just right, they feel it physically. They'll have trouble sleeping, they won't feel right, their stomach will hurt and everything, because if it's not right, they're bonding. They are one with their hi-fi.
So you're talking about something that's metaphysical. It's not just lifting the cables from the floor.
No. It's a total identification, a man-machine or man-hi-fi system connection. So they're neurotic about it. But I think most audiophiles who are really, really into it are neurotic in that when their system isn't sounding good, it does affect them. They get nutty over it. They try to figure out, it sounded amazing on Tuesday, and then on Wednesday I played the same exact music and it didn't sound as good. Like on Tuesday it was a 10, and then on Wednesday it was a 7 maybe. And they say, why? Everything's the same, But it really, not everything is the same. You know, the temperature's different, the humidity's different, their wife was giving them a hard time about picking up the kids from school, you know, the power coming out of the wall may have been really noisy on Wednesday and cleaner on Tuesday. There's a million variables, and then the biggest variable of all is your head, you know, how you feel mentally. Are you stressed out? You know, what kind of day did you have? All of those things make people, you know, weird.
David, do you find the same challenges when you're recording, when you're at a site and you're in a church and the temperature is, I don't know, 36 degrees and you got to start recording? Do you find
That's
that
happened,
those things,
though.
Do they make difference in the sound,
yes,
the equipment?
Well, yes, first of all, we don't record unless the equipment's on for 24 hours. I think equipment has to be thermally stable, especially in the studio. When we work, we never turn the equipment off. My stereo at home has never been off. It's been on. We just turn it on. It's on all the time. So I think it's important, you know. I think air pressure, humidity affects the microphones, and also it affects, you know, how things sound. I mean, I've never done a comparison, but it would be an interesting test to record the same equipment up at 5,000 feet in Colorado than at sea level and see what things sound like.
Thinner, higher. Right.
Sorry. Yeah.
And when you listen at home, and let's say you're testing a new piece of equipment, what criteria then would you use if you think that it has changed somehow?
I don't know if it's changed. I listen to recordings I know, and recordings I play it on, so I really know what the recording is. And then I listen back. First of all, I put the piece of gear in the system, let it burn in for a few days. And then I listen to it on all the time and just see if it, I really think it goes backwards or forwards. You know, it's very difficult. Things become different. It doesn't mean it's better or worse, you know. We're changing microphones all the time. I'm right now on my quest for tonal accuracy because I think all high-end audio is wrong. Real music doesn't sound like this. It's very, you know, it sounds great, but it's not real. But it's fun, but it's not real. I mean, there's two boxes. My own personal thing is to try now to start to make a series of new recordings with new microphones we're building that sound real. You know, they may not sound as exciting and zippy, but when you listen to these recordings with violins, a real violin doesn't sound like this at all. They're very rich and dark and mellow. And when you listen to these symphonic records, you know, it's so peaky at 5 kilohertz to 8 kilohertz, it rips your head off. And if a violin sounded like that in real life, you would never get a job in a symphony. So this is what I want to do, is find the right transducers. And I think it all starts with the microphone and the mic preamp. You know what? If you have a $5 million stereo, if the microphone is no good in the mic preamp, all the stuff down the line doesn't matter.
I think it's also similar with Steve. If the violins don't sound right in the speakers he's evaluating, they won't get the job.
Well,
or an amplifier or a converter.
Yeah, I mean,
because you're on the receiving end. I mean, it has to perform also for you.
Yeah.
You know, not just like musicians have to perform, equipment has to perform for you.
It has to say something to me, you know. I like all different kinds of equipment.
Well, you're a very discerning listener. You've been doing this for many years.
Job, yeah.
More than many of us.
But I think the thing is, it's not just reviewing equipment that I like the sound of, that I would buy myself. No, it's part of it is just thinking about, did the designer of this equipment, their goals, were their goals reached, you know? Is it what they wanted it to be? Like a Vandersteen speaker, I think is great, you know? I think it's coherent, and it's got great tone, and it's extremely open. But it doesn't sound like a Klipsch. Klipsch is kind of the opposite. The Klipsch isn't as tonally neutral, but it's more alive sounding. They're doing very, very different things, but they're both really good speakers.
And you know, in this room, David and I have quads, so we are the majority.
Yeah, I'm outvoted, yeah.
So you have to watch what you say.
You know, I love quads.
We've heard you talk about quads in your
speakers. Yeah, all time. I lived with quad 63s for 8 years. It's one of the longest speakers I've ever lived with over time.
Yes, we've seen that in your...
But then I said, I'm done. I don't need any more quads. I got that sound, and I don't need it anymore.
Well, that's
I moved on.
It's admirable that you've reached that conclusion.
It's a pinnacle, see?
Yes.
It was a stepping stone to other things.
Well, you guys are really busy, and it's so great to have you over at my place. Thank you so much for your time.
Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias. Thank you for having us here.
And don't forget to
tune into Pedro's channel. Yeah.
Don't olviden.
Subscribe.
Subscribe to Pedro's channel.
We watch it. I forget which side it's on. We're looking in this direction, but hit the button, subscribe. And you gotta tell people when they subscribe. They don't just subscribe, they have to hit the little bell.
That's right. I've seen that many times. Yeah. I haven't said that yet, I think.
Well, I'm saying it for you.
And don't forget to go visit HD Tracks. No olviden ir a HD Tracks, donde pueden encontrar su música favorita en alta resolución. Y el canal de Steve Guttenberg, que acaba de conseguir 100,000 suscriptores. Muchas felicidades,
Steve. Is that good?
Wait. Good.
Good.
Ciao. Bye.